Abortion has been front and center at the Supreme Court this term. Today, the justices issued their opinion on a restrictive Texas law. They are allowing abortion providers to continue challenging the measure in lower courts, but the law stays in place for now. John Yang picks up the story.
Judy, this is about Texas SB 8, the law that effectively bans abortion after about 6 weeks of pregnancy and allows private citizens to sue people who help a woman get an abortion. For reaction, we went back to two advocates on both sides of the debate in Texas whom we've talked with before. Marva Sadler at Whole Woman's Health in Austin, which is an abortion provider, and Rebecca Parma from Texas Right to Life.
I was hoping for the opportunity today to be able to tell a woman yes and not have to tell her no. The bright spot and where I'm feeling hope is that the fight is not over. We do still have a chance to go back and to rectify and to fix this horrible thing that has happened.
We're celebrating the fact that the Texas Heartbeat Act is still going to be saving, you know, about 100 preborn children and their mothers from abortion every day. We'll continue to fight for the law at the lower court, but today we're celebrating and we're grateful the law's still in effect.
For what all this means and what comes next, we're joined by Marcia Coyle. She's the chief Washington correspondent for the National Law Journal. Marcia, this was a procedural issue, as Justice Gorsuch noted in the court's opinion. He wrote, "The ultimate merits question, whether SB 8 is consistent with the federal Constitution, is not before the court, nor is the wisdom of SB 8 as a matter of public policy." So what was at stake here and what happens next?
Well, John, the real question before the court, boiling it down, was a procedural question about who can these abortion providers sue in order to block the law, if not permanently, temporarily, while their challenge, their constitutional challenge, goes forward. And so that's what the court had to decide today and did decide. It narrowed who the abortion providers wanted to sue down to roughly just four people who have licensing authority over doctors and others who might be accused of violating the ban.
So then what's next now that they said this case can go forward?
That's right. It goes back to the federal district court that initially was trying to hear it before the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit stepped in and stopped everything. The abortion providers and the others who sued to challenge the law can now know who they can sue, and the federal district court will hear their challenge and decide what kind of relief they should get, if any.
And even though the basic constitutional question wasn't at stake here, Chief Justice John Roberts, joined by the three liberal justices, seemed to telegraph his position or their position on this. He wrote, "The clear purpose and actual effect of SB 8 has been to nullify the court's rulings. The nature of the federal right infringed does not matter. It is the role of the Supreme Court in our constitutional system that is at stake." Now, back in September, this same set of four justices said they would have blocked the law from taking effect. Why did the five other justices keep it in effect, keep this law in effect?
Well, back in September, they said it was because it presented complex procedural questions about who can be sued, who the abortion providers could get an injunction against. But they resolved that today. So I'm not sure. I have no special insight into their thinking why they would not block it right now, except maybe they have an eye on the Mississippi abortion case, which they heard on December 1st. Mississippi bans abortion after 15 weeks. And perhaps those five conservative justices think if once that case is resolved, it will have an impact on the Texas case. And then if you want to be totally cynical, you might think that these five justices don't place a very high value on the particular constitutional right at issue here, women's right to an abortion.
And as a matter of fact, some of the conservative justices have talked about the abortion distortion, that they feel that abortion rights get special attention sometimes.
Yes, they have said that over the years. We're going to have to wait and see how the Mississippi case plays out. That, as you know, John, is a direct challenge to Roe versus Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey, the landmark abortion rights rulings. But the tenor of the arguments on December 1st don't bode well for maintaining the abortion right, at least as it now exists. We'll just have to wait
and see. And tell us how the court works. I mean, after those oral arguments last week, do they have a sense of where each other stand on this?
Oh, I'm sure they did. The usual practice is, depending on which day they hear the argument, is to vote almost immediately after the oral argument. And that can be a very tentative vote on how the case should come out. Much can be done during the drafting of opinions, and whoever was in the majority in that first vote who writes the opinion. So, I think it was Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg who said back during the Affordable Care Act, it isn't over until the fat lady sings. So once again, we have to wait and see how that's going to turn out.
The NewsHour's very own Chief Justice, Marcia Coyle, thank you very much.
Thank you, John.